Hey everybody, today I'm going to talk about selling and accepting an offer on your spec build. So there's a few different things we're going to touch base on here. If you're selling your spec home, if you put it up for sale while it's under construction, and you can do that as soon as you break ground on it, you could do that before. You know, you can sell your spec home as a concept. So if you own a lot and you've got a floor plan for your home, And you know, even if you don't know exactly what the build cost is, there's a way around that too, but if you've got a plan and you've got a lot, you know what the build cost is, you can put a listing on the MLS, and it just has to call out that it is, you know, conceptual or it hasn't been built yet. And I guess what an approximate completion date on that would be. So that would be one way to go about selling the spec home. And who knows, maybe you're gonna get somebody that's gonna see that and they're gonna say to themselves, yeah, this is perfect. You know, I love the location. I'll be able to pick some of the finishes that, cause that would be something you would call out in the listing or in the information as, you know, buyer to be able to choose finishes on the home. So that's something that, there's some buyers out there, I think, that would like that. So it's like building a home for them, except things are streamlined because there's already a lot, there's already a home plan. Things are kind of already underway so they don't have to wait as long to build the home. If you do get somebody that is interested in the home very early on like that, the best thing that you could do, because this will free you up to be able to move on and build another spec home, but the best thing that you could do is have that buyer go and get their own construction loan, kind of, you know, take over. If you've already closed on the construction loan, maybe you've got the foundation in the ground, you know, maybe that's kind of the point in which you're at. So you're early enough on to where some lenders will be okay with giving the buyer a construction loan to basically take over from there. So you would just figure out the difference between what the sales price is and what you've spent so far on, you know, excavation, basement walls, steel, whatever you've got into it so far. And then that would be the amount that they would go and get the construction loan for. Before I get too far into this, I want to give a shout out to Nick Holte. So Nick is one of my clients, and this was actually an idea. He said, hey, you should have something that talks about, or a checklist or something like that, a sheet, a form, that if somebody's building a spec home and they sell it, you know, these are all the steps to follow and make sure that are, you know, being incorporated. If the home is a little bit further along, and or maybe the buyer just does not want to go and get a construction loan, and you still want to sell the home to them, because if you've got somebody that wants to buy the home and you can get an accepted offer on the home and you can get a nice refundable deposit so that you can get that commitment to know that they're not going anywhere, even though they can't close on it until the house is done, you may still want to go ahead and accept that offer, because it's good to know that you've got somebody that is going to pay you for that home the day that it's done. So if you sell your home and the buyer's not going to go and get a construction loan, and this is probably the most common scenario, then you're gonna wanna make sure to get a non-refundable deposit from this buyer. Reason being, I just wanna jump in real quick and talk about my consulting service that I offer. So I've got a website that I've built. It's got a resource section with all kinds of great forms, budget sheets, selections forms, checklists for everything that you need to do. We've got a community feature in there, so anybody who's a part of this membership can interact with other builders, share experiences, share wins. We've got a live Q&A session that we do every week, so you can come on and face-to-face with me and some of the others in there and get your questions answered directly from me. And then I do post videos specifically for that. So if you're interested in that, I've got the link in the details below. If I'm at the stage where I'm framing my home and I get somebody that comes in and they're interested in the home and we're gonna write an offer on the home, I've still got, you know, it could be 5 months before the house is gonna be done. And there's a lot that can happen within those 5 months. So I wanna be comfortable and confident that the buyers I'm agreeing to an accepted offer on are not gonna go anywhere. And if they do, I've got a good chunk of money. And really, they're not gonna wanna go anywhere if they're putting down a sizable down payment. That's gonna be motivation for them to not go anywhere else, not look at any other houses, but to follow through on the accepted offer. And I will actually put a checklist about this. I'll have this in my membership consulting service site. I've got a resources section in there where I've got lots of different downloadable forms and items. So that's where I'll put that. So if you do get an offer and you're writing the offer with the buyer, then you've got a little bit more control on how things are going to go. You're going to sit down together. You're going to kind of go over everything. But a lot of times the buyer may have a realtor. So the realtor may talk to you prior to writing the offer, and they may want to get some information from you. They're going to need to know certain dates and other things like that, because they may not have a lot of experience with writing an offer on a property that's not finished yet. So they're going to be looking to you for some of this guidance. So you're going to want to let them know that, hey, I want to get a large non-refundable deposit, because we've got a long time before right now where we are today and between the time that this closes. So I just want to make sure that, you know, that the buyer's not going anywhere. Number two, if the buyer is going to be making changes or upgrades with any of the selections that I have already picked, then those are going to be amounts that they're going to have to pay right away, right up front. So again, that's also kind of like part of, in addition to the non-refundable deposit. So the more money that they are giving up front out of pocket and knowing that they're not getting back, the greater your chances are of them following through with it. And I've never had anybody not, so I'm not trying to scare you and say, be wary of this. But if somebody's putting down $25,000 and then they're making $5,000 to $10,000 of changes, they're typically not gonna be walking away from the transaction. Once you've got the non-refundable deposit amount ironed out, then you're gonna be looking at the closing date. You're gonna need to give somewhat of a closing date. So if you're in the stages where you're framing the house, make sure to give yourself some time. You know, so if we're in July today and you're framing, we've got August, September, October, November, December, you know, you can say the end of the year and you can say on or before, you know, but give yourself enough time so that ideally you don't have to amend and extend the closing date. And you can tell them, hey, look, I know this is a ways out. I'm giving myself a little bit of fluff time, but I can assure you, I wanna finish this as quickly as possible. So if we finish before the date that's in here, we can close earlier than that. And then you wanna make sure that you're crystal clear, that they are crystal clear with what's going in the home. If you're selling the home and it's not even framed up yet, you got to make sure that their understanding of the blueprints, and then once it does get framed up, I would walk them through the house as well. And as far as finishes that are going in the home and selections that you may have picked or may not have picked yet, you want to make sure to give them all of the information that you currently have. And if there are selections that you haven't made yet, you're going to want to identify what amounts are for those. So say you haven't picked out your flooring yet, you still may want to just go and pick out what you would normally be picking out so that you can get an overall amount of what that cost. That way the buyer, if they want to pick out their own flooring, they can go in, they know what their budget is as far as the dollar amount for flooring. If they pick something that's more than that, then that additional expense, say it's another $2,000 for what they picked, they're gonna cut you a check for that amount. So they're gonna pay for any overages or upgrades or changes. They're gonna pay for that right away up front. Otherwise, you can't proceed with incorporating those changes. You wanna make sure that they know exactly what's gonna be going in there. So for anything that you picked, if these are things that you can't maybe show them physically or in a picture, they could maybe go and look at they go to the fireplace company, they could look at the unit that's gonna be getting installed. Or they could go to the flooring company and look at the floors that you picked. Or interior doors, maybe you've got somewhere they can go and look at those, or maybe you've just got, you know, at least a picture that you can show them. You just don't wanna get into a situation where you've got an accepted offer, an agreed upon amount, and something gets put into the house and they're like, well, I didn't know that's what was going in there. And now you've got an issue. So for anything that you've picked, if you're able to show them what those picks are and then let them know, you know, maybe they want to change something or they're not happy with one of the picks that you've made, they could go and choose something else. but you can let them know what the price difference is going to be. So for interior doors, for example, you can show them the interior door that you've picked for the house. And then you can let them know, you know, hey, if this isn't something, I haven't ordered these yet, so if you want to pick something different, you can do that. And I'll let you know, you know, here are some other doors that are of the same price point. Or if they, you know, bring you a picture of something that they want, you could find out what the price is for that. And then if there's a price difference, you would let them know what that price difference is, and they would cut you a check for what that amount is so that you can go ahead and order them. So I mentioned Nick earlier in the video. He got an offer on, he's doing a twin dominium side by side, and he is at the point where there's not even any framing, just the foundation's there. And he's got an accepted offer now, and he put together a nice little packet that showed, you know, the staircase and the type of newel post and railings that he was going to be using, and the interior doors and the door handles, and he put in, you know, the kitchen cabinet. So he made this nice little handout so that anybody that was interested in the home, they've got a clear picture as to what the finishes in the home are going to look like. And I would highly recommend doing that. You know, the other reason that you want these extras or changes paid for out of pocket and not just being added to the sales price of the home is for the purpose of the appraisal. So especially nowadays, because of where building costs are at, there are sometimes issues with appraisals, with appraisers trying to find comparables for, you know, a home today that you're paying $80,000 for the lumber package for, compared to the same home last year that the lumber package was $25,000 on. If they're using that home that was built last year, it's still somewhat new, they're using that as a comparable, well, it's probably not going to really compare out. So you don't want to add to the sales price above and beyond what your normal sales price was. So that would be a reason for that. Also, that's something that you're going to want to address in the offer, is you're going to let the buyer know and the buyer's realtor know that, hey, this cannot be contingent on appraisal. This is the same as if somebody was going to be building a home with me. They would be going out, they would be getting the construction loan. The build amount that I give them is what the building contract is. That's the amount that they're going to go borrow. It's the same thing here. We don't really negotiate with the prices on our spec homes because it's a new build. We already know the amount of profit and overhead that we want to make. And yeah, you may have certain reasons why you may negotiate, and it's fine to do that. But overall, we really don't, especially in the market right now. If there's not a lot of inventory out there and there's good competition, there's no reason to negotiate on the price. But that's one thing that you do want to let the buyers know is, hey, look, if this doesn't appraise out, you need to be able to come up with the difference. And you're going to want to see that they're able to come up with the difference before you accept the offer. Now, you'll see that because when they write the offer, there's going to be a financing contingency in the offer, unless they're paying cash for it. The financing contingency that's in the offer is going to show you the amount that they're borrowing compared to what your sales price is. So you're going to know that, okay, they're putting down $20,000 or $40,000. And so you can see that they're not just putting down the bare minimum down payment. And again, you want to make sure you're crystal clear with the realtor and with the buyers up front about the appraisal. And if it doesn't appraise out, you know, are you able to come up with the difference and be prepared to come up with the difference? I'm not saying that that's what's going to happen, but it could happen. And if it does, I'm not going to renegotiate on the purchase price. And I'm just, you know, if you're not willing to know that that could happen and to know that you may have to come up with the difference, then we can't accept the offer. So a quick recap, if you're getting an offer on your home that's not yet done, you wanna make sure you've got a sizable, non-refundable down payment. And this doesn't have to be earnest money. You know, earnest money is basically monies that are gonna be held in an escrow account until the closing happens. And if the buyer backs out and they're within their contingencies, they can get that earnest money back. Or even if they back out and they're past some of their contingency timelines, you don't have to give the money back, but you're going to be tied up and you can't sell your spec home until you're settled with the buyer. So you don't want to be in a situation like that. So if you're getting a non-refundable deposit, And again, be clear with the buyer. Hey, this is a deposit that you're giving me. This isn't going to be refundable. If something happens or you can't move forward with the purchase, this is non-refundable. So you want to make sure you're doing that as opposed to earnest money. So get that non-refundable deposit. Then be very clear about all of the selections that are going to be included with the home and any details that need to, you know, if the home's not framed up yet, they've got a copy of the blueprint, they've got a copy of the selections, they've got a copy of the survey. Any and all information that you have, you want to make sure that they have and fully understand. Because that way, if something comes up, hey, they've had the information here. It's not like you withheld information and now they're just finding out about something. And then again, with the selections, if you can make a packet with pictures that shows what you've picked, or send them to some of these showrooms so that they can see what you pick. Just make sure that they are clear about everything they're getting. Number three, if they're gonna upgrade any of these selections, letting them know that, hey, this again is gonna be something you're gonna have to pay the difference for upfront. This can't be added to the sales price. So I need you to pay the difference upfront for any changes or upgrades that you're gonna make. Changes, you know, like say they want to add a window or they want to move a wall, something like that. You want to make sure you're getting paid for that before you actually do the work. You know, you want to make sure you're getting a check for the window before you go out and order the window. Because if something happens and you order the window and they back out, well, now you're eating what the cost of the window is. And then the appraisal, you know, making sure that they know if it doesn't appraise out, you're not gonna renegotiate on the sales price. So those are the main things that you want to account for in your offer to purchase. You know, if they wanna put a home inspection in there, that's fine. I mean, it's a new build. You're having your town, city, or village inspect the home anyway, so I can't believe there would really be much that would come up there. So there shouldn't really be any issues there. You know, make sure you've got the closing date set far enough out to where you know you can finish the home by that date. That way you're not getting to a certain point and the home's still 3 weeks away from being completed and you now have to amend the closing date. Technically, the buyers don't have to sign that. Now, they did give you a non-refundable deposit, so they're not gonna get that back, but they could walk away from the deal because the closing date's not gonna happen. And even though you're giving them an amendment and saying, let's extend the closing date, they don't have to sign that. So, you know, make sure you're good with all of those points there. And you should have a successful sales transaction and closing on your spec home. That's all I got for this one. Have a great rest of the day. If you don't subscribe, please do so and click the little bell icon for notifications so you get notified when I do more videos like this. Have a great rest of the day and God bless.